Today on Matters of Fact, President Rodriguez Duterte is enjoying unprecedented public support and approval as he delivers his fourth State of the Nation address. He also controls a supermajority in Congress, which is expected to deliver his legislative agenda in the next 3 years. But legislation can be much more complicated, especially in the second half of a president's term, where support is typically reduced as politicians look to move on to the next viable presidential candidate. Joining us today is Cabinet Secretary Karlo Nograles, who is also a former member of the House of Representatives. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Good morning, Christian.
Before we go straight to the President's State of the Nation address this afternoon, let's talk about the controversy or the interesting events in the House of Representatives, because the leadership would naturally affect your legislative agenda. As far as you know, as far as Malacanang knows, is the speakership settled already?
I think the congresspersons will be electing Alan Peter Cayetano as the speaker for the 18th Congress this morning, yeah. In fact. So I think lahat naman ng mga kongresista ay nag-uusap-usap na, lahat ng mga partido ng koalisyon ay nag-uusap-usap na, at I think planchado na yan. So ngayong umagang ito, magbobotohan na for the speakership. And I think it will be Alan Peter Cayetano.
Malacanang is no longer expecting any surprises.
We don't expect any surprises as far as this morning's election for speakership is concerned, including the majority leader. That yun naman ang pinaka-importante sa House. As far as the State of the Nation address is concerned, ang pinaka-importante when you talk about the election for this morning's purpose, para sa purpose na pag-receive at pagtanggap ng Pangulo, yeah. It's just basically the speaker and the majority leader ang pinaka-importante. But I won't be surprised if there would be some deputy speakers who would be elected as well this morning.
But what do we make of this simultaneous breakfast meetings, one called by presumptive speaker Alan Peter Cayetano and the congressman who replaced you in your district, the son of the president, Paolo Duterte?
Wala naman ako nakikitang conflict. In fact, I heard si Alan Peter Cayetano will be joining also the breakfast of Representative Paolo Duterte. Kasi parang mauna yata yung kay Congressman Paolo, 8 o'clock. And then yung breakfast kay Alan Peter Cayetano will be at 8:30. So I think he'll be going to the 8 o'clock first before going to the 8:30, or sabay-sabay na lahat from the 8 o'clock to the 8:30, something like that.
But why do separate breakfast meetings? Masyadong mabubusag yung congressman for breakfast.
I mean,
especially the optics of it, why would you organize two separate breakfast meetings?
I don't want to speculate kung bakit, but it could be as simple as siguro because Paolo is a new congressman, he happens to be the son of the president, baka kinansyawan lang siya na magpa-breakfast naman siya. So it might be as simple as that.
But Malacanang does not sense any, let's say, undercurrent or effort on the part of the son of the president to somehow move to jeopardize the election as speaker of Alan Peter Cayetano.
Well, let me get this straight, no? The cabinet or the executive branch does not meddle into the affairs of the legislative branch.
But the president himself settled the speakership row.
Well, the president, given that he is the head of PDP Laban and it is the biggest party,
yeah,
in terms of numbers at the House of Representatives, obviously his opinion or his preference holds a lot of weight. So when the president spoke and said that his preference was Alan Peter Cayetano, it was in the context na siya yung pinaka-head ng PDP Laban. And he, as the head of PDP Laban, a major political party, yun na nga, meron ding karapatan si Pangulo na magsalita tungkol sa kanyang preference. But as far as the cabinet members are concerned, the executive branch is concerned, as much as possible, we don't want to meddle into the
affairs of course, you don't expect the congressman not to toe the line, not to follow the president's endorsement.
Yes.
Or let's say, what kind of optics would it show if you have the son of the president campaigning for a different candidate for speaker?
Sure. And that's the reason why I think when the president spoke and said, ito yung preference ko, then all of the PDP Laban members in the House and all the other major coalition members, meaning to say NPC, Nacionalista, and all of these major political parties, NUP, even the party list group, and Lakas, no, they all supported the preference of the president.
Okay, let's talk about the legislative agenda of the president for the next 3 years, the second half of his term. You have Alan Peter Cayetano there, presumptively, for the first 15 months, followed by Lord Alan Velasco.
Yes.
So basically, you are in full control of the House of Representatives. Does it naturally mean that you have no problems when it comes to your legislative agenda?
Well, we hope so. We hope that the House of Representatives, including the Senate, will be supporting the legislative agenda of the president going into the second half of his administration. And the first item in the agenda would be the budget.
Yeah.
As we all know, after the State of the Nation address of the president, one of the first proposed legislation that will be submitted by the executive or by Malacañang to Congress would be the proposed budget for 2020. Then you have to remember that sometime in August, we will convene the LEDAC,
yeah,
or the Legislative Executive Development Council. And pag-uusapan dun kung ano yung maging priorities ng 18th Congress. So binabangga dyan yung priorities ng Speaker, ng priorities ng Senate President with the priorities of the President. And then we'll take a look at what are common priorities, what are not common priorities, and then we'll see where we could find a middle ground dun sa mga priorities ng legislative branch and an executive branch.
So what are the president's priorities, which will be included in his SONA this afternoon?
I don't know if it's included in per se in the State of the Nation address, no. But what the items that hindi nakapasa ng 17th Congress that we hope to be able to push in the 18th Congress would be the National Land Use Act, right sizing of the national government, the Budget Reform Act, delineation of the specific forest limits, the coconut levy fund,
yeah,
utilization.
The problematic coconut,
yes,
levy fund.
The Department of Disaster Resilience was as part of the SONA speech ni Pangulo the last time. Mandatory ROTC, the FOI, strengthening the Human Security Act, and pension reform for uniformed personnel, among others.
Okay, so this will be relayed by the president when he speaks before Congress later.
I don't know if all of these will be said per se by the president in his State of the Nation address, but these were called from the list of priorities that we had in the 17th Congress, yeah, that did not pass in the 17th Congress. Therefore, it will spill over to the 18th Congress.
Now, why do you think some of those items were not passed by the House and the Senate? Of course, we understand that some of them were hot-button issues.
Yes.
But the rest, they seem to be not so much.
Most of them, nakulangan ng oras. No? Like the Department of Disaster Resilience, nakulangan ng oras because the one who was heading that in the Senate was Senator Lauren Legarda, and she was very busy with the budget impasse that happened. So, then the mandatory ROTC, nakulangan din ng oras yan. Coconut levy fund utilization, we know it was vetoed by the president because he wanted a different version. His concern with the version passed by the Senate and the House was it was, to his mind, akin or similar to the road board fund. And because he had recently abolished the road board fund, he did not want the coconut levy to be the same structure as the road board.
So what does the president want to happen there?
What he wants to happen
who should handle and distribute those funds?
He wants a separate body and not necessarily the PCA to be the one to handle it, because to his mind, the PCA as it is structured, hindi siya kampante na magagamit ng PCA yung pondo correctly. And again, he was afraid that it might be abused just like the road board fund.
Now, the FOI, you mentioned that again. So that is expected to be among the priority measures of the president, but it basically didn't move in the House of Representatives.
Yes, that's why the president issued an executive order. And in his executive order, FOI can now be accessed, no, through the FOIE executive order.
But this is
public
only for the executive.
Can now have access to the executive branch, no. But that's why, because he could not wait for Congress to act on the FOI bill, he created an executive order on FOI as far as his territory is concerned. But what the president wants is for Congress to really pass an FOI so that it will institutionalize the freedom of information in government. Because as we very well know, if it's just via an executive order,
it can be changed.
The next president, the next administration can cancel that altogether. And that's why he wants it institutionalized by Congress.
Interestingly, didn't mention charter change.
Actually, it's there. Federalism is still part of the legislative agenda that will spill over necessarily from the 17th Congress to the 18th Congress. But again, it will really depend on the House of Representatives and the Senate, how hard they will push for federalism.
But how hard will the president push for federalism during the next 3 years of his administration?
Well, as far as his actions are concerned, even after, even before the 17th Congress concluded, and this was during the time na patapos na yung 17th Congress, he created the Interagency Task Force on Federalism. And that task force continued the work ng constitutional, what do you call this, commission?
The consultative
commission that on federalism. So kung ano yung naiwan na trabaho nun, pinagpatuloy pa rin ng task force on federalism para pagdating ng bagong kongreso, kung ano yung natapos ng task force, and this is building on what was completed by the consultative commission, ibabalik pa rin namin sa kongreso for their study and their consideration.
But what are your realistic goals here? Because the president admitted a few months back that federalism might not happen or take place under his watch.
Obviously, it will rely heavily on both the House and the Senate.
Yeah.
As far as the House is concerned, mukhang mabilis naman ang House when it comes to talks on federalism and constitutional change. But when it comes to the Senate, we have some challenges there. So we don't know how hard how successful we'll be. But remember, we have three new allies in the Senate.
Yeah.
Si Senator Bongo, si Senator Francis Tolentino, and si Senator General Bato de la Rosa.
And you also have Aimee Marcos, who's not exactly part of it, but
yes,
a supporter of the president.
Yes, and we just recently concluded the last elections na karamihan ng mga pinush ni Pangulo na manalo bilang senador ay nanalo naman. So we'll see. No? Every Congress has its own dynamic. Every Congress has its own set of people running both houses. So there are a lot of dynamics that come into play. And obviously, it's the second half of the president's term. So tingnan natin. It's too early to really say, but we'll have to look at how this is going to play out in the next couple of months.
Because
time is of the essence.
Yeah, we know how things go during the second half of a president's term. Basically, political support tends to weaken. But the president here is enjoying record numbers as far as approval and trust ratings are concerned. Do you see the president somehow breaking the mold?
Yes,
in the next 3 years?
That is exactly what we want to happen. And we're very encouraged by the numbers. We want to see the numbers in terms of satisfaction, trust rating of the president continuing even beyond this year. So that with that, with the president's influence still holding sway, then it will be easy for us to continue the reforms that the president wants, especially in Congress.
What will be the tone of the president's speech later?
He will be speaking about a lot about his anti-corruption drive. He will still talk about this anti-drugs, anti-crime drive, anti-terrorism drive. He will also be talking a lot about the Malasakit program. So if you look at the president, consistent naman siya, no? It's Tapang at Malasakit, even when he began his term in 2016. And the Tapang aspect has been, you know, he's really focused on that. And he's really been known for the Tapang aspect. In the next 3 years of his administration, we'll be focusing now on Malasakit, no? Without forgetting the Tapang aspect.
So last,
and when we talk about Malasakit, Recently, we just passed the Magna Carta for the poor.
Yeah.
So I think the with President signing the Magna Carta for the poor, I think the focus now would be adequate food, water, education, housing, and health. So these are the components of the Magna Carta for the poor. So rightly so, in the second half ni Pangulo, ito na yung magiging focus natin.
Now, last year, during his SONA, he said that the drug war would remain relentless and chilling. So will this trend continue?
Yes, for
during the next 3 years?
Yes, absolutely, because the president has always said from the start of his term, even during the campaign, he would be relentless sa anti-drugs campaign niya. Also because we have to understand that drugs really destroys the future of the country. And lahat ng efforts na ginagawa natin, when we talk about, sabi natin sa Magna Carta for the poor, no, all of these efforts for to reduce hunger, to reduce poverty, for education, health, social welfare, will all go to waste if the drugs, illegal drugs, comes in to play in the community and even in our families.
Now, will the president also spend a part of his SONA to defend himself in the face of criticism, as usual, coming from the UN Human Rights Council and those who signed the resolution, the human rights groups that continue to criticize his bloody war on drugs based on the latest updated figures, at least 5,500?
Well, I don't want to say defend. I think the president will just elaborate on his actions, on what he's doing and why he's doing it. Just like a good father of a family. As a good father of the family, you have to explain to your family members why you make the decisions that you're making. And you have to make hard decisions for the benefit of the family. So, pag nagsalita si Pangulo regarding that, it's just to explain his actions. It's just for people to understand why he's doing what he's doing and the repercussions of his actions as far as it will redound to the benefit of the family or redound to the benefit of our country.
But before Malacanang said, and also the president, that he would use his SONA to educate the people.
Yes, that's
on
true.
On issues including his handling of the South China Sea issue.
Yeah, that's why I said explain. No? Oh. So yes, educate as well.
Pero is it getting under his skin, the criticism on the way he's been handling China?
No naman. I don't think it's getting under his skin. I don't think na...
Pero mukhang napipikon siya.
Hindi naman. I think he's just very emphatic naman when he explains things. So siguro, he will use the State of the Nation address, and rightly so because it's a State of the Nation, to explain to the people na itong ginagawa niya is really for the benefit of our country. Ayaw niya mapalagay ang bansa natin sa very delicate or mapahamak ang ating bansa at ating mga kababayan. So he makes these decisions, no? And he will always make the decisions that is good for the country and ultimately for the benefit of the Filipino people.
Now, last year in this one, he said that on the issue of the West Philippine Sea, he said, our improved relationship with China does not mean we will waver to defend our interests in the West Philippine Sea.
That's true.
Did he meet this goal or assurance of his?
Yes. In fact, we're building up our fleet. Our Navy fleet, we're building up our Coast Guards. We're putting structures where we need to put structures in terms of our island groups, just to ensure and emphasize that we are sticking by our claim and we are not wavering in our commitment to defend our islands secure our islands.
But he also allowed China within our exclusive economic zone.
Alam mo, well, ayokong pangunahan si Pangulo, no? So let's see if he speaks about that when he educates us about that.
But he said already he would educate the public about that.
Yeah, that's true.
His actions, basically allowing China within our exclusive economic zone, because the threat is that he might have committed an impeachable offense.
No, it's not an impeachable offense because we never let go of our sovereign rights, our sovereignty over our territory. We will stick to our claim. We have stuck to that claim, and we will abide by what is written in the Constitution and our laws. So, pagdating sa even in our exclusive economic zones, we will continue to explore. We will continue to exploit. We will continue to extract from there, as it is rightly within our sovereign rights, and we will not abandon that. We will still continue to do that.
Okay. Now, another priority of the president during the campaign, he would end contractualization. But of course, I think he realized it's much more complicated. But Congress already delivered the security of tenure bill.
Yes.
Will the president sign it, veto it, or allow it to lapse into law?
As far as I know, it's being studied right now because obviously there are concerns about the bill.
The employers are against it.
Well, some sectors in the management side or the employer side have given or have communicated to Malacañang and to the president their concerns about it. So the president's weighing his options. And tingnan na natin kung anong gagawin ni Pangulo pagdating sa dulo nito. But again, the president is looking at his options and he's weighing his options carefully.
But your deadline is July 27.
So like you just said, no? May different options si Pangulo dito. He could have it lapse into law, he can veto it, or he could sign it. Mm. So right now, it's still something that is... That the president is seriously considering. He's listening to all sectors, basically. And he's studying all of the repercussions as far as that bill is concerned.
Mm. Now, regarding the report that there would be a minor reshuffle in the cabinet of the president, when is this expected to take place?
I really don't know. We all sit at the pleasure of the president, so we really don't know what the timeline is. The timeline belongs to the president.
But there would be one.
I don't know. That I'm not really too sure. Siguro, if any, siguro the a vacancy created, perhaps if the president accepts already the resignation of Secretary Manny Piñol, maybe that would be maybe the minor or the reshuffling that will happen.
Why has he has not accepted it?
Well, as far as I know, in the last cabinet meeting, Secretary Piñol sat. Was still there in the cabinet meeting. So, and this was after Secretary Piñol wrote his letter and sent it to the president. So I would assume that that means that it, at that point in time, it had not yet been accepted formally by the president.
Okay. Now, finally, this is halfway into the president's six-year term. What do you think has defined, from Malacañang's perspective, the president's first half of his term?
In terms of economic development, I think our economic numbers are showing that we've grown the economy by 6.5% in the first 3 years of the Duterte administration. As far as poverty indicators are concerned, all poverty numbers show that there has been a reduction in poverty as well.
Unemployment also
has gone down. Underemployment has gone down as well. And if we talk about human development, we have the free higher education law, we have free irrigation, now we have universal health care, and then now we have the Magna Carta for the poor. And as far as crime, corruption, and drugs is concerned, you know that the president is really hands-on here, and he's really bent on eradicating corruption, drugs, and criminality. Reducing it to the barest minimum.
But the fact that thousands were killed in his centerpiece drug war, was it worth it?
These are things that obviously when it comes to police operations, we hope that, you know, ultimately at the end of the day, we would really eradicate crime and drugs. During the tenure of the president as president. When it comes to police operations, obviously we would want that for less casualties to happen, but we want to be as efficient as we can, and that's why we have increased police visibility. We have increased the number of police stations. We have increased the numbers of policemen so that it would deter crime from happening. And by deterring crime from happening and deterring drugs from happening, then we would see a reduction of these numbers.
Okay, Secretary Karlo Nograles, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Thank you for watching. Now, for more videos, subscribe to the official ANC YouTube channel and click the I button. Thank you.